Hey guys, welcome to the first Obsidian Painting Show. If you want to skip ahead, the times are there right now. We're going to have different segments. If you want to just skip ahead and watch something in particular, there you go. All right, enjoy.
1 minute tip.
Have you ever wondered what kind of brush you should get? I mean, with all the different kinds of brushes out there, it can get a little confusing sometimes. The first thing that might pop in your head are these. Nylon brushes. Inexpensive and dispensable. You'll find, however, that you have to replace these brushes every so often because they hook, fishtail, or just plain fray. That's not good. The synthetic bristles don't tend to last long, and that can get quite annoying. A good alternative, however, are red sable brushes. Made from natural hair, they come to a sharper point and last a little longer. If you maintain them, they could last you years. These will definitely improve your painting ability, if not for the smoothness of the bristles alone. However, if you really want the best bang for your buck, Klinsky sable brushes last even longer, and you'll find that when using them, they are like the Cadillacs of brushes. Go check them out.
Color Madness.
Timmy, today we're going to learn color theory.
No! This is madness!
No, Timmy, it's not madness. This is painting.
All jokes aside, color theory is good to know. It helps you choose which colors work together, how to shade colors, highlight colors, etc. It essentially will help you with the theory behind painting. What you're looking at right now is the basic color wheel, also known as the primary color wheel. These three colors, red, yellow, and blue, make up the primary colors. It is impossible to make these colors from mixing other colors, and every other color is made from mixing these colors. Usually in a color scheme, you pick one of these colors and then base all the other colors based off of what goes good with this. Generally, primary colors don't work well in a color scheme together because using them tends to look a little childish, as these colors are bright and happy. When you mix these colors together, you get other colors. Mixing red and yellow makes orange, red and blue makes violet, and blue and yellow makes green. These are known as secondary colors. And secondary colors are good to know, as knowing how to mix colors is essential to knowing your paint scheme inside and out. When you finally mix secondary colors with primary colors, you get tertiary colors. These are in-between tones that complement their parent colors. When creating a color scheme, it's good to know what color is available to you. Also, understanding which colors work together is a key to creating an effective paint scheme. The easiest way to get started in this is using what's known as complementary colors, colors opposite from each other on the color wheel. And if you look, red and green are opposite of each other. That means that when you use red and green together in a color scheme, they'll work really well. Green will make red look more red, and red will make green look more green. And because of this, it creates this really harmonious effect. And try it with all these other ones and experiment. Have fun, guys.
New stuff.
So today I got my commission for Annex SG. This is where I'm at right now. I just want to see what you guys think. See what Annex thinks. I'm not done. I'm still going to be doing stuff to it. I just wanted to see what you guys thought. And I painted him red. These are Honor Guard. They're not Sanguinary Guard. They're the Sanguinary Guard models, but they're going to be Honor Guard in the game. So, and you won't be able to see the magnets once the arms are on, so don't worry about those. Just let me know what you guys think.
It's inspiration time!
Thank you.
So I'm going to show you guys how to magnetize some stuff today. And what you want to do to start out with is you want to build the torso of your model. You want the legs, you want the torso, and the head put on. Unless you want to magnetize those parts. I'm just going to magnetize the arm today. I'm going to magnetize this powder fist. Okay? And this will allow you to interchange weapons and stuff. Because say, what if you wanted to put, say, another arm on there? Like this arm. Right? What are you going to do? You can't just rip the arm off and then put the other arm on. That's just ridiculous. So what we do is we magnetize the models. And how to do this is we're going to drill holes and then we're going to glue magnets in. And the glue I like to use is Loctite Super Glue. And I get the gel kind because it's not as liquidy as the other stuff. And the cool thing is it's just a squeeze on the side and then it comes at the top and you're good to go. So I'm going to use Amazing Magnets, 1/8 inch magnets for arms, and I also use those for jetpacks and the backpacks or whatever. And then for like hands and stuff, I use 1/16. So what we're going to do is we're going to drill a hole in both the arm and in the torso, so that way they line up, and then the magnet will just snap into place and you're good to go. So here's my 1/8 drill bit, and I actually use a pair of like pliers because using your fingers it'll rip it to shreds, so don't do that. So I use this because I actually couldn't find anything else to friggin' put the drill bit into that would fit. So I just put that on, I grip the curve on it, and then I just hold it and twist. So it's actually really awkward to do on camera because I wasn't able to get the strength I needed to go through quickly. So it actually takes me a little bit to do this. But essentially you just want to drill it through, and don't use a friggin' electric drill, a handheld drill. Don't use those, the battery powered ones. They'll just go whoop and you'll have no model anymore. Go right through, and you don't want a model that has friggin' a hole in it. That's not cool. So use your hand. It doesn't take much. You only need to go in a couple millimeters and you're good to go. So you just want to keep doing it until you get the hole the right size. And just be careful with it. Don't slip. Don't let it kind of come off and get your finger or something. Just take your time and have fun with it. It's not too complicated. It looks a little kind of like I'm freaking out a little bit, but it's just really awkward to do on camera. So I keep having to reposition the model in my hand, whereas normally I'd just be able to crank my right arm, but I kept hitting the camera when I did that, so yeah. So once you get the hole kind of like the right size, you're going to want to test fit the magnet and see. And look, there you go, magnet fits perfectly. Then you're going to want to glue it in there. So you get your glue, you put it in, and if you have any like little bits of excess stuff, just use a knife and cut that away. So I realized that I haven't actually used this particular bottle in a while, so the glue is kind of a little gross. But that's okay, it'll work. It'll do its job. And I like to put the magnets on the end of my drill bit because it's easier to stick in. See? Just like that. Bam! Done! Perfect. Clean. And then you just want to do the exact same thing to the other, to the arm, but you want to make sure it's the opposing magnet so it actually sticks to the arm. Alright? And then once you get that going, you're good to go.
Paint!
Hey guys, so today for the paint tutorial, we're going to be doing a quick gold. Quick and easy, dirty, there you go. So you get Shining Gold, Griffon Sepia, Devlin Mud, Calthan Brown, and we're also going to use Burnished Gold. Okay, these are all GW paints, and you'll see the effect at the end. It'll be pretty decent, and it's pretty quick. It doesn't take long at all, and you can do lots of guys up like this, and it'll look fantastic. Okay, so The first thing you need to do is we're going to mix Kalthan Brown with Shining Gold. Okay? And the ratio to this doesn't really matter. You just want it to kind of... The Kalthan Brown will darken the Shining Gold a bit, and also because it's a foundation paint, will make it cover better. And we all know the problem with gold is it doesn't cover at all. So, using the Kalthan Brown, we can kind of combat this. So as you see, I'm just kind of mixing it in there, Shining Gold. And I'm going to add possibly a drop of water. No, I already did. Never mind. I'm crazy. So you're just going to paint that over. Just like that. Just get it on there. And you may have to do 2, maybe 3 layers until it's completely opaque and covers the whole surface. But that's okay. Alright. So once you're done there, just let that dry and you'll be good to go. So next, we're going to give it a wash of Griffon Sepia. And I find that using this as a wash, the sepia really kind of brings out some nice tones in the gold, I find anyways. And it really makes it look a little bit more like gold, because there's a little bit of yellow in the Griffon Sepia, there's a little orange, it's really nice color, and it really makes the gold look like gold. And you just want to let that pool into the recesses there to define the shadows. And then that's pretty much it. You just let that dry and then we'll move on to the next step. So the next step is adding Devlin Mud. So this is just to kind of make it a little bit more darker and add more shadows. Gotta shake up your pots. So I'm just going to take that, and I'm going to apply it mostly to the recesses there, and let it pool there, so that way it really darkens the shadows, because that's what this whole wash right here is for, just to darken the shadows. Right, and there's no real fancy way to do it, you just dip your brush into the wash and then you apply it to the model. And the cool thing about these is they kind of pool in the wash and the recesses all on their own. GW had it good when they made these. And that's what we're dealing with right now. And next what we're going to do is we're going to highlight it. So we're going to kind of brush on Shining Gold. And essentially what we want to do is we want to take your Shining Gold, put it on your brush, and then wipe most of it off. Some could say this is dry brushing, but it's not really dry brushing because I'm not just dusting it over the model. I'm actually just taking the brush and kind of just pulling it down so that way it does hit only the raised areas, but because we're not dry brushing, it kind of comes on a little bit more. It's a little bit like a mix between layering and dry brushing. It's kind of neat. And it gives a really nice effect. So then we're going to do the exact same thing with Burnished Gold. But the thing with Burnished Gold is you want to make sure a lot of it's off the brush, because Burnished Gold is really pigmented and it is really yellow, and you don't want it to be too much of a yellow color. So you just want a little bit of the Burnished Gold, and you want to just put that right on the raised areas. And it'll look fantastic. And that's what that looks like. So you could stop there, but I'm going to actually do one more thing. And I'm going to add another wash of Griffon Sepia. This time, not too much, just enough to bring back some color. As you can see, I'm not really letting it pool. I'm just letting it just kind of glaze over almost. And I'm almost specifically applying it to the recesses. Yeah, and then you just let that dry, and you're done. Quick and easy gold. And here's what it looks like. That was quick. Took like maybe 10 minutes tops. And you can do that batch painting really easily. Excellent. Hey, so thanks for watching. This is the first time we've done a show like this. Let me know what you guys think, okay? If you liked it, let us know, and we'll keep doing it. All right, thanks, guys.